Hello everybody, Gavin McCormack here. Just wanted to check in with you and talk a little bit about independence in the classroom and in school and explore what independence really means, what it looks like, and how we can actually establish that routine in our classrooms that allows for that to happen. Now, we talk about soft skills or essential skills, and there are a huge array of skills out there that we can focus on. You know, we can talk about compassion, understanding, empathy, love, persistence, determination. All of these ones are absolutely fantastic. But what actually supersedes all of those and surpasses every single one for me is the skill of independence. Now, we talk about independence as a skill that enables children to work on their own, independently, and really not requiring assistance from anybody else. But there's a little bit more to it than that, and it takes, a shift in the way that we teach and we establish our classroom routines in order to really, really see independence working. Now, traditionally, teaching was established as a role where the teacher would stand at the front of the classroom and impart knowledge onto their students. And the students would remember that information, and then a test would occur at the end of the week, and if everything was remembered, then that was considered learning and that was considered teaching. Now, those times are long gone, as we all know. Many schools now taking on independent learning and project-based learning and talking about following the child and allowing the children to choose their own route in this educational journey. But how can we set up our establishments and our pedagogies in a way that allows independence to flourish? Well, let me explain from my perspective how I see that actually working. So if we take a look at traditional teaching, we go back 100 years where the teacher is at the front for 7 hours of the day, distributing knowledge, and the students are then receiving that knowledge and retaining it. Those, as we said before, those times are gone. What we need to do now in terms of making sure our education pedagogy is moving forward in a way that allows those skills of independence and compassion, understanding, communication to flourish is not treating the teacher so much as a teacher, but treating them really, or calling them, a guide, and making them a bridge between the child who is here and the knowledge that is here, and literally joining them up. And your job as the teacher is very simply to inspire your students. So, for example, if you were teaching about volcanoes and it was in geography, you may wish to not teach them everything, but inspire them to want to know more about volcanoes. And what that might look like is, yes, there'll be some direct teaching where there might be a diagram on the board, there could be a textbook with some text that you might read together, but that would only take a small section of the lesson, maybe 20 minutes of your 1 hour. And that extra 40 minutes you have left over is a bit of a void there. You know, the question is, what do we do when we get to the end of the 20 minutes? Well, that's where the secret lies. And at the end of that inspirational chat that you've had, where you've talked about Mount Vesuvius exploding and being the loudest volcanic eruption on Earth, and flooding Pompeii with a pyroclastic flow that was traveling at 500 kilometers an hour and was melting steel in its path, and the children are extremely excited by these conversations. The end of that direct teaching, which is about 20 minutes, finishes with the teacher saying to the students, "Now, what would you like to know about volcanoes?" And what we find when we do that to our classes is that every hand goes up in the room, every single one, and everybody has a question. And that some of the questions may be very, very highbrow, some may be really, very simple, but they're all valid. And whether the question is, how hot is lava, or do you think that a super volcano will erupt in North America within the next 10 years? Those questions are all valid questions and should be taken on by the teacher. And what I like to do is put them up on the board and say, thank you for your input. They're wonderful questions. And then you pass it to the students in that 40 minutes and you say to them, now, you have 40 minutes in this lesson. You can answer one of these questions, or you can answer all of these questions. You can work with whoever you like. Your research tools are all around the room. They could be books, they could be the computer, they could be a friend, you could go into National Geographic magazines, you can come and ask me. There are many places where you can find the information, and you can work with whoever you like. But in 40 minutes time, we're going to find out what you've learned and what you know about answering some of these questions. And what you're essentially doing at that point is handing the curriculum over to the students and saying, I trust you, I'm listening to you. I want you to have a say in your education. But the freedom that you have is a freedom within limits. It's not do whatever you want when you want. It's we all have to study volcanoes, but I'm going to let you choose how and who you study it with. But you have to feedback to me later about what it is that you have learned. And what you will find then when you let go of your students and you allow them to go and have that 40-minute slot of time to go and embark on their own research journey is two things. Number one, the students will work collectively. They will work together in groups or in pairs, or they will work on their own, but you'll be able to see your future leaders. You'll be able to see those collaborative skills taking place in the classroom. But you'll also be able to see who wants to work on their own, who is an independent learner, and do you have space for them on a regular basis to be able to work on their own? But the most amazing part about this whole kind of dynamic change in terms of the way that we teach is that in that 40-minute slot when everybody goes off and starts embarking on their research journeys, you as the teacher can step back. You have time. You step back. You're not required anymore. You're just a facilitator. And what do? Do you have a cup of tea and a piece of cake? Well, no, you don't do that, although that would be really nice. You take out your notepad and you observe your students and you take some notes about the skills that you see in front of you. Who's collaborating really well? Who's communicating really well? Who's having a debate with another child about who's getting the paint to paint their volcano, but actually that debate's not going very well and the power dynamic is not working, and therefore you need to work on some skills of a compromise or understanding or collaboration. And you can have a look for those skills. And the reason that I say this and put this video out there is because it's very hard to teach those skills. But what we can do is allow the skills to be demonstrated in front of us and then take heed of what's there and what's missing and establish routines that allow our classrooms to be a place where students can practice their skills. Because ultimately, we don't know what the future holds. We don't know what academics our students are going to need in 12 or 15 years when the world has completely changed. But there is one thing that we definitely do know, and that is that these skills, the essential skills that we talk about so often these days of love and empathy and compassion, understanding, time management, resilience, determination, you know, these skills are the skills that will always have a place in our community. They will always have a place in our society, and they will always allow our students to innovate and improvise with a future that we are yet to understand. There will be problems ahead of us that we are yet to foresee, like the COVID-19 pandemic that we're sitting on right now. We want our future leaders to be able to be resilient enough to deal with what is around the corner. And by making this kind of this shift in the way that we teach in our classrooms and taking the power away from ourselves and allowing the students to go with that, we allow them to develop those skills for a future. I hope that this has helped you out there, and I hope that you can take this on. Give it a try in your classroom. It takes a bit of time to get used to, but once you establish a routine where the students understand that the time is theirs and that you are busy observing, you start to understand your students a whole lot better, not just academically, but also emotionally and socially, and then you can adapt your classroom and your learning environment to suit their needs. Thank you very much for all your support out there. I hope you're staying safe and keeping well. Good luck with Term 3 and for the rest of the year. And anyone in the Northern Hemisphere, have a wonderful summer break and look forward to speaking to you soon. Goodbye.